In the 19th century, in the first wave of comparative mythology, much energy was expended on the notion of the great vegetation goddess and how this was seen to be evident in all the cults of the old world, the cults of Tammuz and Attis and Sibyl. These were all seen to be particularized historical expressions of the great vegetation goddess. Goddess was focused quite tightly on this image of the mushroom. The only previous foray into trying to inculcate mushrooms into early human origins is Gordon Wasson's effort to show that the pre-Vedic sacrament Soma was Amanita muscaria. Vedic people, when they swept down from the Caspian Sea area, encountered the mushroom religion. This tradition occurs as late in the West as the Eleusinian Mysteries. The Eleusinian Mysteries were herbicized rye beer that a non-toxic strain of Claviceps paspalli was actually infecting the rye which grew on the Eleusinian Plain, and that a beer was brewed out of this, which was the intoxicating sacrament of Eleusis. The strongest competitor in terms of an interpretation of the Eleusinian history, which is that the recipes for the Eleusinian ambrosia always contained words which could be arranged in such a way so that the first letters, when read downwards, would spell out the word mushroom in Greek. The ingredients of the Eleusinian ambrosia, which were always listed as honey, barley, and water. Everybody knows that water the letter which is necessary to form this cryptogram which explains that it was really mushrooms. Pi Greek culture was derivative from Mycenaea, the Mycenaean kingdom, of which the House of Atreus were the ruling family. Well, this M-Y-C sound is a mushroom sound. It's philologically a clue. The island of Mykonos, if you look in the modern Greek dictionary for the etymology of the island of Mykonos, you find that it is the island of the little bald-headed man. The cattle would be seen as the source of the mushroom. The mushroom would seem to that mentality as obviously a product of the cow, as milk, meat, or fuel, meaning the dried manure burned as fuel, so that the mushroom was a gift of the cow. And then the experience of the mushroom is the experience of this feminine informational matrix that knits everything together and infuses it with numinosity, but it is specifically feminine. So another implication of all this is that the goddess cattle religions of prehistoric Africa and the ancient Middle East are actually Trinitarian religions of which the esoteric third member of the Trinity is a psychedelic compound, probably psychedelic compounds contained in the mushroom. When Wasson tried to show that Soma was Amani and Muscaria, he ignored this very rich set of associations that Hindus have to cattle. I think that probably Soma was not Amani and Muscaria, but it was Stropharia cubensis. Was that it was a male lunar deity. throughout the world, the moon is almost universally associated with the feminine. But in this Soma tradition, you get a masculine lunar figure, and then in Mesopotamia, in the god Nannar, there is also a male lunar deity. The lunar goddess Sibyl is actually his daughter. He represents an earlier stratum of mythological material. One of the unsolved mysteries of ethnomedicine, which if anybody's looking for a project, is to go to India and try and find out exactly what the status of mushrooms is in India now and in prehistory. Hinduism was reformed quite radically a few centuries ago by the introduction of the Mahabharata. The Mahabharata specifically forbids eating mushrooms to high caste Brahmins. One of the puzzles of Wasson's series is, if it was so wonderful, and when you read the ninth mandala of the Rig Veda, it is clearly wonderful. If it was so wonderful, then how could they have ever lost it? And I think the answer is probably it occurred through a series of stages. Originally, it was the orgiastic intoxicant of a general tribal group. Then, over time, it became the secret property of a priest class, and knowledge of it was much more restricted. And then, there was a popular rebellion against the priestly hierarchy, and the priests and everything associated with them was swept away, and the mushroom went with it. This is the only scenario I can imagine where a psychedelic drug could actually be lost to a culture, other than massive disruption in contact with another culture. There are Aboriginal people in India, people not of the Indo-Aryan stock, or even of the Dravidian stock, the tribal people in Orissa and Bengal called the Santal. And they have, unlike the Orthodox Hindus, they have a tremendously rich mushroom vocabulary. They have hundreds of words for mushrooms. They recognize 50 species of common names. They eat 12 species. In other words, they appear to represent a mycophilic culture that was extant in India before the Indo-Aryan invasion. Their relationship to psychedelic mushrooms has never been fully explored. They have a very interesting language where everything is designated male or female. Everything is given this designation except one thing in the entire universe, and it happens to be a mushroom. because of essentially Christianity, our connection to the origins, to the goddess and the planet, and what we as moderns call the unconscious, but that ocean of depersonalized information that you access with these plant hallucinogens. Because of Christianity, we have been cut off from this. Whatever Christianity was, it was a historical episode where the most patriarchal rat extant on the planet was suddenly pumped full of so much energy that everything else was just shoved to the walls. And the submergence, the giving up of the ego that is represented by the worship of the goddess in the orgiastic and intoxicating rites that reached back to prehistory, was suppressed. strive as we might, this is the legacy upon which we must restructure our worldview. We can't do anything about the historical momentum that Christianity has imparted to our expectations. All we can do about it is raise it to consciousness, examine it, and then try and think our way around it. But it gives rise, because it was the heir to the late Hellenistic tradition of dualism, it gives rise to these tremendous divisions between the natural and the human world, between self and world, between you and me, between life and death. Thank you. in the Tassili Plateau of southern Algeria, there are cave paintings. Which clearly show human beings dancing, holding mushrooms in their hand, racing in a kind of round dance in one case, and then in another instance, a single human figure with mushrooms sprouting out of the body and with mushrooms clutched in the hands. the visual acuity, even the stimulation of the language center, these things do not address the informational content of the experience of the mushroom, which seems to be that of an other, an intellecty of some sort, which is either the overmind of the species or a very unusual kind of extraterrestrial organism which drifted in here millions and millions of years ago and has somehow inculcated itself into the environment. Nevertheless, I think that as we peel away the onion of nature, things are going to get stranger and stranger and stranger, to the limits of our ability to conceive it, almost. The voice of the mushroom, the question of the mushroom as an intellect, grows, to my mind, murkier every day. I mean, I used to firmly believe it was simply an extraterrestrial, and we're going to have to come to terms with the fact that in the ecology of this planet, there was another minded species, but that it was just so different from us that the task was to cognize it, and that it in fact had probably been intelligent and on this planet longer than we had. I was willing at one time to entertain a sort of Jungian oversoul, collective unconscious, or personified as the psychopompic archetype which teaches. But you know, this is like conjuring. This doesn't explain anything. It's just some kind of stream of gobbledygook. I mean, Jung talks about autonomous psychic complexes which have escaped the control of the ego.